Good morning. Today we are going to solve free response question number one from the 2019 AP Physics 1 exam. Bobby, please read the question through part A.
Flippin' physics.
Identical blocks 1 and 2 are placed on a horizontal surface at points A and E, respectively, as shown. The surface is frictionless except for the region between points C and D, where the surface is rough. Beginning at time TA, block 1 is pushed with a constant horizontal force from point A to point B by a mechanical plunger. Upon reaching point B, block 1 loses contact with the plunger and continues moving to the right along the horizontal surface toward block 2. Block 1 collides with and sticks to block 2 at point E, after which the two-block system continues moving across the surface, eventually passing point F. Part A. On the axes, sketch the speed of the center of mass of the two-block system as a function of time from time TA until the blocks pass point F at time TF. The times at which block 1 reaches point A through F are indicated on the time axis.
Thank you, Bobby. Billy, could you please walk us through your solution to part A? And make sure to go section by section. In other words, start with as block 1 goes from point A to point B, and then from B to C, and so on.
Okay. As block 1 goes from point A to B, it experiences a constant positive net external force caused by the plunger, which, according to Newton's second law, causes a constant positive acceleration. So draw a line with a constant positive slope from time A to time B. As it goes from B to C, block 1 experiences zero net external force because there is no friction and the plunger is no longer pushing on it. Therefore, block 1 moves at a constant velocity, so from time B to time C, starting where the previous line ended, draw a horizontal line. From C to D, block 1 experiences a constant negative net external force caused by the friction between the block and the rough surface, which causes a constant negative acceleration. From time C to time D, starting where the previous line ended, draw a line with a constant negative slope.
How do we know the line does not go all the way down to the time axis at time D?
We know the block is still moving to the right after point D, so the speed of block 1 at time D cannot be zero. Right, Mr. P?
That is correct, Billy. Please keep going.
As block 1 goes from D to E, there is no friction, just like from B to C, so draw a horizontal line again. But when block 1 is at point E, it collides with block 2, linear momentum is conserved during the collision, and because blocks 1 and 2 have identical masses, the speed of block 1 is cut in half because the mass is doubled and the momentum of the system stays constant. So suddenly at time E, the speed of block 1 drops to half its value. But then from E to F, again, no friction, so it is a horizontal line until F.
When you look at where block 1 is when it collides with block 2, the collision occurs before block 1 is at point E, so the drop in speed on the graph should actually occur before point E.
I do not think we should draw it that way, because it says in the problem that block 1 collides with and sticks to block 2 at point E.
But that is not what the drawing shows.
Actually, it does not matter, because y'all did not read carefully enough. We have not solved this question correctly.
No way.
Yet.
Mr. B?
No, you gotta be. That's...
It is true. This graph is incorrect. Who can tell me what we missed?
The question asks for the speed of the center of mass of the two-block system as a function of time.
Yeah.
My graph is for the speed of block 1 as a function of time.
Yeah, it's even written on the graph right there on the y-axis.
Speed of center of mass.
Duh.
Right, the graph you created is for the speed of block 1, not the speed of the center of mass of the two-block system. So, Billy, please fix your solution.
Okay, well, everything I described was just for block 1, but it is still correct. So, from A to B, block 2 is at rest. The average of a constant positive acceleration and at rest is still a positive constant acceleration, just with a smaller magnitude. So again, draw a line with a constant positive slope from time A to time B, just with a smaller magnitude. Actually, there is no y-axis scale given in the problem, so we can just draw it the same way as before, right?
Right, because there is no y-axis scale on the graph provided, this question is really about the shape of the graph rather than the actual numbers. So yeah, we can draw it the same as we did before.
Okay, from B all the way to E, block 2 is at rest, so again, we average block 1's motion with block 2 being at rest. From B to C, that is still a constant velocity. From C to D, it is still a constant negative acceleration. From D to E, it is still a constant velocity. But the two blocks collide at E. Oh, but according to Newton's third law, the force from block 1 on block 2 is equal and opposite to the force from block 2 on block 1. Therefore, the net force acting on the two-block system is still zero. Those two forces are internal to the system, so the acceleration of the system all the way from D to F is still zero, even during the collision. So the velocity of the center of mass of the two-block system is constant from D to F. Draw a horizontal line from time D all the way to time F.
Now that we have the correct graph, I have a bit to say about grading. Part A is worth 5 out of 7 points for this problem. That is right, drawing lines correctly on this graph is worth 5 out of 7 points. No explanation necessary. Please draw graphs carefully, and do not write out your explanation if you are not asked to. I have put it on the screen to help you understand why the graph is drawn this way. However, none of the explanation is necessary as an answer to part A. Only the lines drawn on the graph are necessary. Also, realize you only lose 1 point for incorrectly showing a decrease in velocity at time E, and I will point out that of the 3 sample student solutions published by the College Board for this problem, exactly 0 of those students drew a horizontal line from D to F. So, if you got that wrong, you are in good company. Please, read carefully and slowly. Please read part B.
Part B. The plunger is returned to its original position and both blocks are removed. A uniform solid sphere is placed at point A as shown. The sphere is pushed by the plunger from point A to point B with a constant horizontal force that is directed toward the sphere's center of mass. The sphere loses contact with the plunger at point B and continues moving across the horizontal surface toward point E. In which interval or intervals, if any, does the sphere's angular momentum about its center of mass change? Check all that apply. A to B, B to C, C to D, D to E, and or none. Briefly explain your reasoning.
Thank you, Bo. Bobby, please answer part B.
Well, we know angular momentum is conserved when the net torque acting on an object equals zero, so let's look at all the forces acting on the sphere and see if they cause a net torque on the sphere. Force normal acts on the sphere from A to E. The force normal is directed toward the center of mass of the sphere and therefore will not cause a torque on the sphere. The force of gravity acts on the sphere, again, all the way from A to E. The force of gravity acts on the center of mass of the sphere and therefore will also not cause a torque on the sphere. The force applied by the plunger acts on the sphere from A to B only, and the force applied is directed toward the center of mass of the sphere and therefore will also not cause a torque on the sphere. The force of friction by the rough surface acts on the sphere from C to D only, and the force of friction does not act on the center of mass of the sphere and is not directed toward the center of mass of the sphere, and therefore the force of friction will cause a torque on the sphere. Therefore, the only interval where a net torque is acting on the sphere is from C to D, and that net torque is caused by the friction force acting on the sphere.
Please put a mark next to C to D.
Very nice, Bobby. And I have another note about grading. Our explanation for part B in this video is a bit excessive. My goal is for you to truly understand all the physics here, which is a bit different than simply answering the free response question. You really only need to say that change in angular momentum is caused by net torque, and that the force of friction from C to D is the only force which causes a net torque, and explain why. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.